If you have your Bibles this morning, if you'll turn to 2 Samuel chapter 24 with me, I want to talk about just that right there. I want to talk about the relationship. But I also want to talk to you about something that I'm extremely passionate about. And it's, oh my goodness, I am so passionate about this. It's everything I am. So I want to talk to you about that this morning, but I'm also going to ask you for a favor. So listen close, because I'm going to bring you right into this sermon. I'm going to ask you personally for a favor. So your part's coming up. Be prepared. Everybody ready for that? And I'm going to ask you for a favor. In the book of 2 Samuel, King David does something that I feel is one of the most admirable moves he ever made. I love this story because of what he does here. And David has some pretty shining moments in his life, and he has some pretty shameful moments in his life. You read the life of David, and you're like, hey, that's a good one right there. And then you see he goes polar opposite. The adultery with Bathsheba. You see, man after God's own heart right here, taking down Goliath, and man, that's a powerful story. And then you see his sin with Bathsheba, and like, what happened? Is that the same guy? He's got some good moments, and he's got some pretty bad moments. But in this story, he does something that has completely earned my respect. I look at this story, and it's one of the most powerful things he does in his life, in my opinion. In this story, he numbers the armies of Israel. Now, that's not the part that earns my respect, okay? At the beginning of this story, what he's doing is he's numbering the armies of Israel. And this is a sinful act, because what he's doing here is he's allowing his powerful position to get to his head. He's numbering all the people. Look how many people I have in my army. He's focusing on his position, his pride. He's inward focused on this part of the story. God sees this, and he wasn't pleased with the actions of the man he put in charge over Israel. I placed you as king over Israel, and now you're just adding up all that you have done and everything that you have, and it's kind of an inward focus thing here. So God's not pleased with David. So God does something very unusual for David. He offers him options for how he will be punished. That's just awesome. You ever had that when you were a kid, when your parents give you an option? Go choose your own switch, that kind of thing, and you get an option, and you think, I'm going to get the flimsiest little tiny switch I can. Unwise. Unwise. You want to bring in a branch that they can't lift. That's what you want to bring. I remember those options. Like, I'm just going to grab this little flimsy thing. That is a whip. You wake up like that. When you've been given an option for your punishment, sounds like it's pretty good. Till you realize you've got a huge problem here. I'm going to get punished either way, but I get an option. So God sends his prophet Gad in to deliver the list of possibilities for David to choose from. I'm going to give you an option, David. You're getting punished, but I'm going to make this optional. You get to pick which one. Look at 2 Samuel 24 and verse 12. It says, go and tell David, thus says the Lord, I offer you three things. Choose one of them for yourselves that I may do it to you. So Gad came to David and told him, and he said to him, shall 7 years of famine come to you in your land? Or shall you flee 3 months before your enemies while they pursue you? Or shall there be 3 days plague in your land? Now consider and see what answer I should take back to him who sent me. What a deal. What a deal. Famine, enemies, plagues. What more could a guy ask for? I mean, he's got options here. God says, hey, I'm going to give you three choices. Pick one. You're getting one of them, but you get to choose. Could you imagine getting a non-negotiable option from God to determine your own punishment? And what I mean by non-negotiable option is means you're going to have to take one. That's not an option. That's non-negotiable. You do have to take one of them, but which one you take is totally up to you. To me, that would be terrifying. I'm doing this to myself. you're going to give me the punishment, but how much am I going to cry about it when I get it? Because it's the one I picked. You know, I don't like this. I don't like this scenario at all. It always puzzled me why God gave David the choice. This is the only time he does it. This is the only time God does this. I'm going to give you an option. Here's three things. Door number one, two, or three, David. Which one you want? You're getting one. Just, you get to pick. You get to pick which one you want. It always puzzled me why God gave David a choice until I realized what God was doing in David's life. God was helping David get back on track. And he's letting David choose, because in the decision itself, David was going to learn something. He's now not only getting punished, he has to think through every one of those punishments and figure out why he would do it or why he wouldn't do it. It's more than just getting consequences. It's thinking the whole process through. These are the consequences I'm going to get if I choose this. Why would I choose it? Why wouldn't I choose it? He knows he deserves any one of them. But he gets to pick which one he wants. So there's a whole lot more thought going into it than you just got punished. God was helping David get back to where he was supposed to be. So look at David's answer to God. He's talking to Gad, and he gives the answer back to God. Verse 14, and David said to Gad, I am in great distress. Please let us fall into the hand of the Lord, for his mercies are great. But do not let me fall into the hand of man. Even though David was allowing his own power to go to his head, he didn't forget about the mercies of God. He never forgot about the mercies of God. God is merciful. He's so merciful. When Gad offers him his options, David asks to be placed in God's mercy. Which one you want? I want the one that's filled with the mercies of God. Give me that punishment. I could run from my enemies. I could do that. But if I fall into the hands of man, the wickedness of mankind can be relentless. It can be relentless. It's merciless. Humans can be so cruel. And David says, yeah, I don't want their mercy. I don't want my enemies' mercy. Why don't you go ahead and let me fall into the hands of God? Because even though I'm going to get a punishment, I'm also going to get his mercy, because his mercy never fails. I will always have his mercy. So I pick to fall into the hands of God. Whatever God was going to do was going to be wrapped up in his characteristic of mercy, and David knew it. He's locked in. He does not change. So throw me into that pit with God. Throw me into that one. I'll take that punishment. So David chooses to chase after God again. That's what he chooses in his punishment. I'm running after God. In the punishment, I'm seeking God. That's what I want. God sent a plague to Israel. And it was a pretty harsh plague. But when he saw the suffering of the people, he saw what they were going through, he saw the people dying because of the plague, he chose to stop the plague from spreading, and he sent a command to David. David needs to know there's something he can do here. Look at verse 18. And Gad came that day to David and said to him, go up, erect an altar to the Lord on the threshing floor of Araunah, the Jebusite. So David, according to the word of Gad, went up as the Lord commanded. Now Araunah looked and saw the king and his servants coming towards him. So Araunah went out and bowed before the king with his face to the ground. This guy sees the king coming down the road to his house, and he's humbled by the man David. Okay? He sees the king coming, and he knows who David is. He knows David's reputation, and he's humbled that this man David is coming his way. Remember, even David saw himself as something before all this happened. He was feeding his own ego. He's counting how many people he has in his own armies. He sees himself as something. He's letting his own ego get out of hand. Now, one of his citizens sees this amazing king coming his way. So now, not only David saw himself as something great, even the citizens see David as something great. This reputation has spread. Araunah is so humbled that he bows himself and puts his face to the ground. He sees the king coming, and he's so humbled that he's coming. That he bows his face to the ground. David could have easily let his ego take over again, but his focus has changed to what it should be on. David's focus has completely changed. Look at verse 21. Then Araunah said, "Why has my lord the king come to his servant?" And David said, "To buy the threshing floor from you, to build an altar to the Lord, that the plague may be withdrawn from the people." David has come to purchase a piece of property from Araunah for the purpose of worshiping God. "Why are you here, David?" "I want your land. I want your threshing floor." "Why?" "Because I need to worship our God. I need to build an altar and I want to worship God." He's not trying to make a name for himself anymore. He's trying to give back to the person God created him to be. "I want to worship him. I want to worship God. There's a plague going on. People are dying right now. What do you want to do, David?" "I want to worship God. Because I understand the reason the plague is here is because I was worshiping myself. And I want to switch everything over. I want to worship God. Let me buy your threshing floor so I can worship God." The blessings and the position that David had was given to him by God. He just lost focus of that in the middle of it all. Think about everything you have. Would you have anything you have if it wasn't for God? Even one thing. "Well, it was my job. I did earn the money. So yeah, the things I have are mine because I got them for myself." Who gave you the ability to have your job? Who gave you the strength? Who has blessed you with your heartbeat? Who blesses you every single day? It's God. We lose focus of that in the middle of all the blessings. We lose focus of why we have those blessings. That's exactly what David did. And now he's on a new mission. It's time to stand for what he should have been standing for all along. David's got his heart in the right place. "I've got to take a stand. And I've got to do it to the greatest extent I can do it." When Araunah hears that he wants to build an altar to God, he decides to offer a gift to David to help. "Let me be involved too, David. You want to build an altar to God? I want to help too." Look at verse 22. "Now Araunah said to David, 'Let my lord the king take and offer up whatever seems good to him. Look, here are oxen for burnt sacrifice and threshing implements and the yokes of the oxen for wood. All these, O king, Araunah has given to the king.' And Araunah said to the king, 'May the Lord your God accept you.'" Araunah just offered David an amazing gift here. It's incredible. He presented his own animals to be sacrificed. "Take my animals. Go ahead. Take my animals and sacrifice them." He even offers the yoke that the oxen would wear, the wooden yoke that they would wear, for firewood. "You can take the yoke. You can take the threshing implements. You can take the tools. You can use the yoke for wood for your fire. You can take the oxen for your sacrifice. David, you can have it all." He's not only willing to give the land to David, he's willing to give him everything he needs to perform the sacrifices. David, this is a great thing. Worship God. Build an altar to God. Here's the oxen, here's the wood, here's the land, it's all yours. Go for it. Go for it. This guy was willing to step up wherever he needed to step up. "David, I'm all in. Let's do this." David had it made. I mean, free stuff is always a welcome bonus. Always. When you buy something and somebody goes, "Oh, don't leave, you, because you purchased that, you get this for free," that takes our attention right back to, we turn around. "For free? We don't even need to know what it is. Hey, with that purchase, you get this free. You got me? Say the rest. What is it?" But free, that's a good thing. We all are interested in that. So Araunah offers David all this stuff for free. "You can have whatever I have is yours. I'm all in with you, David." But David didn't see it that way. And this is where David earns my respect. This is the part of the story where he has my utmost respect. David's eyes were opened to something new. He's the king. He is a blessed man. And he knows he is a blessed man. Even the citizens of his kingdom were willing to pitch in to help him. This guy is willing to give everything for him. "You are a blessed man, David. God is with you. You are blessed. Let me bless you. Let me give you everything I have so you can move forward." But David learned something very important from his time of self-indulgence when he looked at all his armies and he was focused on his power and all of that. He was enjoying one side of the relationship. That's what he realized. I'm enjoying one side of the relationship. Yeah, I've been blessed. I have truly, truly been blessed. God has been good to me. And I'm enjoying it. I'm really enjoying it. But I'm only enjoying one side of the relationship. He loved all that God did for him, but he offered nothing in return. I love the God side of the relationship I have with God. David enjoyed that too. When it came to the punishment, he goes, hold on, hold on. I want to cash in on the God side. His mercies endure forever. So I'll take the punishment that comes with God's mercy because I enjoy that side of the relationship. I enjoy what he does. I enjoy who he is. I want to enjoy that side of the relationship. So give me the punishment that includes him, where I fall into his hand, not theirs. I want that. When Araunah offered him the animals, then the land and the wood, David saw things from a new perspective now. Look at how he responds to Araunah's offer. Verse 24. Then the king said to Araunah, no, but I will surely buy it from you for a price, nor will I offer burnt offerings to the Lord my God with that which cost me nothing. So David bought the threshing floor and the oxen for 50 shekels of silver. This, in my opinion, is one of the most admirable moves David ever made. This one's incredible. He finally got it. David finally got it. Everything David had in his life was provided for him by God. God gave him everything. He could have been born into slavery. You could have been born into slavery. Think about what we have. He could have been born into slavery. He could have had so many fewer opportunities in his life. God could have just left him the way he was and never invested in David's life at all. God did have the option. But God invested in his life. Now take it personally here too, because it's meant personally. Everything you have is because God offered that to you. God provided that for you. He could have walked away from you and he would have been right to do so. There was nothing lovable about us. We were lost in our sins. We were separated from God, and he could have left us that way, but he invested in our lives. David realized this, and God could have left him alone, but instead, he was blessed by a God who really loved him. He really, really loved him. When Araunah offered to give him even more blessings, David stepped up and said, no. It's time for me to bless God. It's time for me to be a blessing to God. It's time for me to invest in him. Because I've been enjoying the one side of the relationship a whole lot. But I haven't been offering anything from the other side of the relationship. Nothing. I love what he offers to me. I love what I get from who he is. But I'm not willing to sacrifice to God with that which costs me nothing. So I'm buying the land. If I'm getting the oxen, it's because I'm buying the oxen. If I'm getting the wood, it's because I purchased that wood. I will not sacrifice something to God that costs me nothing. That's not really a sacrifice, is it? Hey, God, I sacrifice this to you. Isn't that his? No, it's yours. That's not really a sacrifice. If you have siblings, you understand. You know, I remember one time when this girl walked past me with something that belonged to me. I'm like, where'd you get that? I'm like, oh, your brother's so sweet. He gave this to me as a gift. Like, and I wasn't going to take it away from her because she could probably take me. So I went ahead and left it alone. I'm like, way to sacrifice. Way to give from your heart, buddy. Good job. It's not really a sacrifice when it costs you nothing. It's still a gift. It's just wrong. I'm sorry, I got to vent a little bit here. That was like 100 years ago. What am I bringing this up for? He gave something to her that belonged to me. Didn't cost him a thing. She thought he was sweet. Cost him nothing. David has this same idea in his mind. Why would I sacrifice to God something that's really not a sacrifice? I can't do it. What a statement. I will not sacrifice something to God that costs me nothing. This was what God was waiting for. This is what God wanted to see. David finally saw the reality of a two-sided relationship. Just two sides. Two sides. David knew he got it right because of the way God responded to David's heart. Look at verse 25. And David built there an altar to the Lord and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings. So the Lord heeded the prayers for the land, and the plague was withdrawn from Israel. Two sides. That's it. Two sides. If you walk out of here today not getting the message, there are two sides to this relationship, and you have thoroughly been enjoying one of those. I don't believe there's a person in here that's like, yeah, I really have been hating how God's been good to me. Not one of us. We have thoroughly been enjoying how good God is. We have thoroughly been enjoying the one side of the relationship. I have been enjoying it. I know you have too. If you're listening online, it includes you also. We have been enjoying the one side of the relationship. Think of how blessed you are to have God as your friend. Just take a second here. Think of how blessed you are to have the God of all the universe as your friend. Anybody feel blessed? I'm blessed. Man, I'm glad he's my friend. I'm so glad. I am so blessed that he's my friend. Now, think about how blessed he is to have you as his friend. Not as comfortable of a feeling, is it? Do we realize there's two sides to this? Think of a marriage. If it was all one-sided, would it last? No, it would fall apart. Think of a friendship. If it's all one-sided, will it last? No, it's going to fall apart. There's two sides to this. And you've been loving the one side. You have been thoroughly loving the one side. We've got to open our minds to the fact that there are two sides to this. Are we missing something? Are the things we offer to God things which cost us nothing? Now let's think about that for a second. Going to church, is it really a sacrifice? No. This is for you, God. Thanks. What did it cost you? Nothing. Nothing. How about putting money in the offering plate? Let's think about that one. Does that cost us something? And immediately we think, yeah, it costs us the amount that we put in the offering plate. That's a no-brainer. Okay, now put yourself in a situation like a Chiefs game. Or putting gas in your tank. Or getting coffee every day of the week from one of these fancy places that say ours is special, but theirs tastes like everybody else's coffee. But you're like, that's an $8 cup of coffee. That's a $4 cup of coffee. We're going with $8 because we need the better coffee today. Don't we throw money around like we have it, even if we don't have it? We throw money around all the time. So let's think about the money that we put in the offering plate. What's it cost you? What have we ever given sacrificially to God? And there's times in my life where I put in till it hurt. You're like, man, and God doesn't require that. That's a great thing. God doesn't require us to give till it hurts. But I was so in love with the cause that I put more money in than was financially smart, because I really, really wanted to be part of that cause. And God did bless me for it. I'm fine. So sometimes you can give to the point where it is truly a sacrifice. But if we think about it, what's it really cost us to throw a few dollars in the offering plate? What's it really cost? Is it a sacrifice? Do we give to God that which costs us nothing? Now think about all the things that you do give to God. How much does it cost you? Is it a sacrifice? Or is it just life? There is a difference. There is a huge difference. Going to church and putting money in the offering plate, both of these things are important. And I'm not encouraging you not to do these things. These are so important. But they are ultimately not what God is wanting to see from your life. He wants you to include that, but that's not ultimately what he wants to see. God made himself accessible to you. Remember that whole Christmas story? God made himself accessible to you. we could not get to him, and he went ahead and says, then I'll get close. I'll make myself accessible. The distance between you and God was immeasurable. There was no way you were ever going to make it. So God went the distance to get you. It didn't go the other way. God went the distance to get to you. Let me show you what real sacrifice looks like. Look at Mark chapter 10 and verse 45. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. That's what sacrifice looks like. That's it. Jesus Christ is the one person who deserves to be served. If anybody deserves to be served and not have to serve, it would be Jesus. But it says that he didn't come to be served. He came to serve. He's the one who never committed one sin. He lived an honorable and obedient life to the Father. He set the example for how we should live. And it says that he came not to be served, but to serve. And to give his life as a ransom for you. That he did that so he could save you. That's what sacrifice is. That's what sacrifice looks like. When Jesus was beaten and nailed to that cross, his mind was on you. And you might be thinking, well, I wasn't born yet. No, his mind was on you. The person right where you are right now, he was focused on you. And he said, this is worth it. It's worth it to have them as my friend. I want that so much. It's worth it. I will lay down the sacrifice. I will be the sacrifice so I can be their friend. He didn't give you something that cost him nothing. Put that picture in your mind. He didn't give you something that cost him nothing. A relationship with you cost him everything. Everything. He went to the farthest extent to show you his love for you. That's an awesome story. That is an awesome one side of the relationship. I love that side. That's awesome. But that's just one side. That's what one side looks like. That's what the one side of the relationship looks like. Now let's look at the other one. Everybody ready to do that? Like, there we flinch a little bit when we say that, okay? Well, let's look at the other side of the relationship here. How blessed is he to have you as his friend? Everybody doesn't smile as big when we think about that side of the relationship, right? Like, I don't know that I've been. We need to be. Remember, there's two sides to this. There's two sides to this. Jesus became the sacrifice to be your friend. What have you sacrificed to be his friend? Not just a child of God. Remember, it didn't cost you anything to be a child of God. We take that one, that's a gift. But what about to be his friend? What does it cost you to be his friend? We have to wake up to the fact that there's two sides to this thing. There's two sides. You can give without loving, but you cannot love without giving. I remember the first time I heard that. Like, man, that's deep. That's really deep. You can give without loving. Fine, here, take it. See, did you feel the love? You can give without loving, but you cannot love without giving. Love produces sacrifice. Anybody have kids? Can one person in here say, yeah, I've got kids, but I've never sacrificed one thing for them. Never, ever. All we do is sacrifice. Yeah, you can have the last one. Enjoy it, and they eat it and go, I don't like it. Like, We've been there. Or you give them something, can I have a bite of yours? And like, it's an acquired taste. It's good. You like hot dogs. I like ribeye. See, you need to grow to this. And like, please. And you give that high dollar something or other to them. We do sacrifice. You can give without loving, but you cannot love without giving. Love requires sacrifice. It produces sacrifice. So God asks us to get involved. He says, I want you to get involved. Look at Romans 12 and verse 1. Here we go again. These verses just pop up over and over again in this church a lot, because this is where we get our church name from. Look at verse 1 here of Romans chapter 12. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. If you've been wondering how you can sacrifice for God, well, here it is. This is it. Live a life that is holy and acceptable to God. Live that life. And will it cost you something? You better believe it. It will cost you something to live this. He says, I want you to be a living sacrifice. Well, what am I supposed to do? Live a holy and acceptable life to God. Well, that'll cost me. Yes, sir. Yes, ma'am. That will cost you something. This world is going to bombard you with reasons why you shouldn't be living a life that is called a living sacrifice to God. It is going to give you so many reasons why you should not be a living sacrifice to God. But if we stop and think about everything God is and everything God's done, I can't think of one reason why we shouldn't be. Not one. I should be a living sacrifice to God. This relationship has two sides. How invested are you in your side of the relationship? How invested are you? We see his investment. What's your investment look like? What's that side look like? Let's take a look at the very next verse in Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12 and verse 2. Says, and do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Before we get saved, our minds are filled with things that will help us get ahead in life. We're all focused on that. When you ask a little kid that is not saved, ask a little kid that is saved, they're still in that mindset. What are you going to be when you grow up? They're picking the good jobs, okay? Not one of them like, man, I just want to be can I dump your trash for you? I want to be that trash guy. That's my goal. Now, they could end up being that, and there is a purpose for that. That's not a bad job, but not one kid says, I want to work with trash. No, they're astronauts. They ask them. They're astronauts. That's one of the top things. They want the good jobs. Before we get saved, our minds are focused on the things that help us get ahead in life. We're trying to better ourselves. We seek for things that help us feel fulfilled. That's what our minds are wired to do. And then God enters into our life at salvation with his sacrificial love. That other side of the relationship comes in and invades your life. You remember that feeling when you got saved? How loved you felt at that moment? How you felt that burden lifted from you? Like, oh my goodness, I just experienced the mercies of God, the goodness of God. I know he's here. I know he's here. You remember that feeling? You remember that? His sacrificial love shows up and he gives us a new spirit and he gives us a new heart. But we still have that old mind. We still have that. This is where our opportunity to sacrifice shows up. This is it. You want to know how to sacrifice? This is it right here. Forsake that old mindset. Renew your mind. Forsake that and find your values and your priority in him. Become the living sacrifice. I'm going to live a life that is holy, and I'm going to live a life that is acceptable to God. Why? What did he ever do for you? Dumb question. He did everything for me. Everything. And I'm thoroughly enjoying the one side of the relationship. And it's time for me to step up and get invested in the other side. Because he is so worthy. He deserves so much. Will it be difficult to forsake that old mindset? Yes. Yes, it will. Will you need help doing it? Absolutely. Don't just say, well, I'm not going to think like that anymore. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. Renewing is not a job where you say you flip a switch. It takes work to renew your thought process. It takes work to think like this instead of the old programming. It's going to take some work. So yeah, it's going to be hard. And yes, you're going to need help. And that's why we have the next few verses in Romans chapter 12. I love the fact that God just keeps it rolling. He's like, oh, and but what if I need help? Well, let's read about that. Look at verse 3. For I say, through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, but all the members do not have the same function, so we, being many, are one body in Christ and individual members of one another. God didn't just ask us to be a living sacrifice alone. He didn't say, hey, you're on your own. Go ahead and be a living sacrifice. He gave us the church. Like, you're not alone here. I know you're with me. Oh, no, no. There's a whole team. I'm bringing in the whole group. You don't have to do this alone. I'm going to give you the church. We are individual pieces of one body. And do we all do the same thing? No. This person has this talent. This person has this talent. I can't sing, but I'll talk. And I'm not so good at that. We all have different abilities. We all have different gifts. And we all come together and make the body of Christ. You're not alone. You're not alone. We're to work together to bring about the desires of God. Let's do this together. We cannot live our lives enjoying the one side of the relationship with God and never investing in the other side. That's not how relationships work. God called Renew Church out. I remember praying with Matt and Kim DeShawn years ago. We're sitting around this little table in Savannah, Amazonia. One of those towns which are the same thing, just different names. We're just sitting out there talking, and we're talking about starting a church in St. Joseph. God did call Renew out. This wasn't just something that people put together. This is something that God put together. God called Renew Church out, and he has placed us in St. Joseph, Missouri, among broken and hurting people. He put us right here in the middle of all of this chaos we call home. He put us right here in the middle of it all. These are people that he loves with all of his heart. Why would he put the church here? Because they're here. And he loves them. He loves them so much. He gave up everything so that he could have a relationship with those people too. What are you giving up for this reason? That, remember, we're in this relationship. What are you giving up for that reason right there? I know that God poured all he had. He poured out all he had to reach me. I know that. And I am so thankful that he loves me so much. Praise God that he loves me so much. And I will devote my life not to be served, but to serve. That is a personal commitment on my part. I'm going to do that because he deserves it. He deserves that. I have determined to live in such a way that makes people want to know more about our God. Do I do it 100% all the time? No, nobody does. But I am determined to live my life in a way that points people to Christ, not an obstacle for them to get to Christ. I am determined to live my life like that. Years ago, I was listening to a sermon, and this next verse took on a brand new meaning to me. I don't even remember the pastor that was preaching this sermon. I just remember the verse and how he explained the verse. And it changed everything for me. It's found in a little book of Luke towards the end of your Bible. A little one chapter book. Just a small little thing. But this one verse packs a punch. Look at the book of Jude, chapter 1, the only chapter, in verse 3. Beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning our common salvation, I found it necessary to write to you, exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith, which was once for all delivered to the saints. In this one chapter book of the Bible, Jude thought it was necessary to remind the people to do something extremely important. Contend for the faith. Contend for the faith. The word contend means to agonize. That's fun. Agonize for the faith. You know those people that go to the Olympics? They don't just get a ticket and go and run in the Olympics or compete in the Olympics. They contend for that position. They agonize. How do your muscles feel? They burn. Keep going. Keep going. Don't stop. I'm going to throw up. I'm so exhausted. Keep going. Keep going. These people don't get there because they got a free pass. They got there because they contend for it. They agonize. Jude says, agonize for the faith. Contend for the faith. That's what that means. Realize that this relationship that God gave you has two sides. It's got two sides. Get behind what God is doing. Get behind what God is doing. If our church is doing something, we should be doing it together. It should not be something where we're watching somebody else do it. We should be getting in there and helping them do it. Don't just watch from a distance and be glad that you are so blessed to see it happen in your lifetime. We got a lot of Christians out there doing that. Wow, I saw God blessed and it was, man, I'm glad I got to see God bless. What part did you have in it? Well, I was a spectator. You sacrificed to God something which cost you nothing? Yeah. How about getting involved? How about getting involved? We really need you to be involved. We need everybody to be involved in whatever we're doing as a church. We need to be doing as a church. We all need to be involved. Live a life that is a living sacrifice to God. Live holy. Live a life that's acceptable to God. Please, please. Don't let those things we consider sacrifices be gifts that cost us nothing. Hey, I went to church today. Good job. And good job. I'm glad you did. I put money in the offering plate today. Good for you. And good for you. Seriously, thank you for that. Thank you. It's necessary. Now go sacrifice something. What am I going to do? Why don't you go tell somebody about Christ? Oh, that's terrifying. Well, that'll be a sacrifice, won't it? That'll cost me something. Go for it. Invest in somebody else's life. Go do that. What if it's hard? That's what a sacrifice is. Sacrifices aren't easy. Let's get invested in this side of that two-sided relationship. Remember, it has two sides. Get invested in your side. Fight for it. Struggle. Contend. Agonize for the faith. Go ahead. Let's get in there. Let's get our hands dirty. Let's sweat a little bit. And let's do it for the cause of Christ. Let's reach people. When you got saved, God called you out. At the beginning of the sermon, I told you I was going to ask you for a favor. So here it is. This is your part. Would you please help us reach this city? Please. As a church, would you please help us reach this city? Would you please sacrifice for the one who gave it all for you? Be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God. Please contend for the faith. Please. As your pastor, I need you. What if it's hard? I'll do it with you. I'll do it right by your side. But don't leave me to do it alone. Please. Because I need you. So I'm going to ask you for a favor. Let's love him. Let's live our life in love for the God who gave us everything. And let's contend for the faith. Please understand there are two sides to this relationship. I am so blessed that God is my friend. Now everybody think about it. How blessed is he to have you as his? Two sides. Be a living sacrifice.